Oh, yeah.
The last problem.
I was just kidding.
What model? So I don't really know. It says, what model appears to be. So I guess I was just a little confused. So for the model appears adequate. So like.
We had our meeting then. It'd be so funny.
Yeah, so that's exactly how I would answer that question. I mean, so I would first start off by saying, well, depending on what my goal is. How I would make it, how would be in the margin policy. And then regardless of, and then now those are two estimation standards, right? So if you told me my goal was to estimate those fixed effects that were up there.
Yeah.
And I would have said, okay, in the marginal setting, it looks like, what did you guys want? What's the EDA doing? Everything. Unstructured.
Yeah.
Flood it over town.
Yeah.
Just go down. Use lots of bullets.
No, I mean, you're in a marginal setting. What are you gonna say?
What'd you do? I mean, you gotta choose models. I realize there's this like, this underlying stress, tension, whatever, where like, there's multiple ways to approach one problem. You know, I know in math, like, I just wanna go, you know, it's either proof by contradiction, proof by induction, or it's poor man's kind of blue collar proof, straight from foundations and principles, brute force, so to speak. But, and they all end up at the same answer. But data analysis does not work like that, right? I mean, there are multiple ways to approach a data set and to approach a problem. And so now, the question for you guys is to become pragmatic in your approach. So now, if I tell you that I'm interested in inference on the fixed effects parameters, what model did you choose? You've got a bunch of EDA here. Why did you do the EDA? Okay, and so why did you do that? To try and buy back as much efficiency as you can through the weighting process, right? Okay, great. Because you knew something about those estimates themselves at the end of the day. Again, it's the same story over and over again. They're unbiased, they're inconsistent. So now the question is try and get the most efficient estimator, or closest to the most efficient estimator, right? The most efficient estimator says, I know sigma, and I have confidence in it. And the answer is, you're not getting there, okay? You're not getting there in practice. So you want to get as close as you can. So in this case, I would argue that you saw certainly minimum randomism. So in other words, there's correlation in the data, right? And then there was some aspect of an AR process, or some serial process. So yeah, it'd be reasonable to go ahead and fit an AR process. And what I would say is, if I was fitting that AR process, though, would I take the naive variance estimators out of that model? In other words, would I trust the fact that I have a truly continuous AR process moving through this model that is constant across all individuals? No. Right? So I would then do some ad hoc adjustment to the variance estimator. Okay. And the one I would be using is when I do the robust variance estimator. So that would be my answer on one side of things. Right? It's a pretty straightforward answer. The other side of things, now you've got to be a little bit more careful, right? So now the other side says, I'm interested in maybe prediction, or I'm really interested in, if you will, characterizing the random effects. So now I'm building this parametric model. And that parametric model is assuming what? It's assuming normality of the response. And it's assuming a fixed covariance structure, right? That is defined by whatever the random effect structure you are putting on that model. That is how you're doing the estimation. Okay? Do you still gain back consistency and unbiasedness of the OLS estimates? Interesting question here. Yeah, you do actually, right? I mean, when you write down the normal model, you take the log of that likelihood, and you take the derivative, what is the estimating equation you get for the fixed effects parameter? It is the maximum likelihood, it is the score functions for us to meet an equation, but what is that equal to? I'll give you a hint, it starts with a W. And it has an L and an S for its initials. It's weighted least squares. It is weighted least squares. That's what it comes down to being. You write it down, it looks like X times W, Y minus V. That's what you will get back out of that for the fixed effects, okay, for the base. Now the difference between that and the marginal approach though is that now when I go to estimate those variance components, I do those based upon maximum likelihood or restricted maximum likelihood estimators. They're not moment-based estimators. Okay. So that's where really the divergence really starts to come in, which is how we're going to deal with the variance components. Okay. And so now though, if prediction is my goal, if I really have random slopes in my model, and I only assume random intercepts, what's going to happen to my predictions? They're likely going to be off, right? Because I'm going to assume that everybody has the same slope. They're just kind of pushed up on it, right? And in reality, they're doing this. Everybody's doing this, okay? So there, now I've got to be a little bit more careful. So if prediction is my goal, I probably at minimum want to go with random intercepts and random slopes if the data are supporting that in any way, shape, or form, right? Which I think you saw.
Yeah.
And then the other question then is to say, oh, okay, if you were not in the random slope case, you could say, well, yeah, but if I have random intercepts, I might still have a serial process that's left over. Again, the random slope process is going to take care of a lot of the serial process. It is dependent upon the model. But if you were in just the random intercept case, you might want to think about now having an AR structure, right? With that nugget on the end of that. So my answer to that, and I purposely wrote it the way that I did, because I want you guys thinking about this. I mean, I encourage everyone here, whenever you get into data analysis, to sit back and just simply first start by saying, what do I want to achieve? What is my goal? And then choose the methods that are most appropriate for that. I mean, far too often we learn we have one tool, you know, and the classic analogy is you give somebody a hammer and everything is a nail. Right? So you will see that over and over again. Most people are only taught GDE, or they're only taught mixed effects models, or they're only taught Bayes inference, or they're only taught frequency. And because of that, if I was only taught linear mixed effects models from a frequency standpoint, and you give me longitudinal data, guess what I'm going to do every time, regardless of whatever my goal is going to be? It's going to be a mixed effects model, but I'm hoping to try and get you guys to see that there are pros and cons to each of these. There are pros and cons to each of the approaches you're dealing with. Okay? And so, depending upon what your goal is, choose the approach that minimizes the cons and maximizes the pros.
Question?
Yeah.
For part C, no. We were asking to compare random slope and random intercept.
Yes. Residual autocorrelation beyond that, it would say I fit a random intercept and random slope model where the measurement error now has an autoregressive structure.
So we shouldn't do that on
the Well, it wasn't mine. It wasn't my implication of the question. You know? Yeah. So it's okay. It's okay that you did it. I mean, that's fine. Because you didn't know. But what I'm talking about right now is I would like to get the terminology down, right? I mean, if you're starting to add on additional correlation structures on top of the measurement error, that usually goes into describing what you're doing. Like, you just say random intercept and random slope. The implication there to somebody is it's sigma squared times the identity for the measurement error. Okay. Now, what you're doing, though, you know, when you do that, so now I'm going to talk about that for a second. So you fit our simple random intercept model, right, that just now did have independence. Is that what you were telling me? And then you fit a random slope model, and then plus an AR structure on top of the measurement error. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then you did a likelihood ratio test. Mm-hmm. Okay. So when you're doing that, then you're testing both the random slope as well as the autoregressive structure, plus if you had a nugget in there, plus the nugget.
Yeah.
Okay. And so it is still a nested model. In other words, you can get from one to the other, so it's a valid test, but it's testing more than just random slopes. And that's why you're rejecting on that one. Not just the random slope model. Okay. All right. Other questions on this? I know the terminology kind of gets hard sometimes, but that's I'm trying to help you guys out.
In this one, you mean D, or we can, in this one, you mean D, or we can ask about the later question?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So in the previous to last one, So one question is what is it we needed to compare? So should we fit like a Deagle model and then a Deagle model plus an intercept? Or should we compare a Deagle model to the previous models with a random slope? So basically, one model is the Deagle, second model is the Deagle with random slopes, and then there were models with random slopes in previous parts.
So my implication here was when I say a random slope model, this is just your random intercept, your classic random intercept, random slope model, right?
Oh, okay.
I mean, so again, random slopes invokes a time-dependent correlation structure. Do we agree with that?
Yeah.
You guys wrote that down actually for me, right? When you wrote those covariances, they were functions of time and like Tij, Tik products. Okay. So most folks will choose either a random intercept plus some autoregressive structure like the Deagle model, right? So maybe some AR process on top of that. So they're saying everybody's got this state, and then our trait, I'm sorry, up or down, and then they got the state process that's going through that's characterized by an AR structure. And then other folks would say, well, I'm going to capture the time dependence of the correlation structure through the random slopes. And sometimes it's you're capturing that dependence there, but also sometimes it's just because you care about random slopes because of prediction, right? I want to estimate individual level trajectories in that case. Okay, so you're doing both. And so when I would write something like that, it becomes natural for me to say the implication is now the random intercept random slope model plus kind of sigma squared times the identity versus the random intercept plus a different AR structure. It's not the random slope model. Okay.
Yeah, and a related question. So to compare the Deagle model with the previous ones, I mean, the only sensible thing I came up with is basically to look at the residual sum squared errors.
Yeah. That's on the prediction side of things. I think actually all I did is I said, how do the estimates of beta and the standard error estimates using the covariance model compared to the estimates using the random slopes, right? I think I was pretty specific there. And really what I wanted you to see is, are there big differences? So first of all, should there be big differences in the estimates of beta? There better not be, right? I mean, you kind of know that already. Just theoretically, you can run an expectation through to get back beta on those estimates. But then what I really wanted you to say is, well, does it really change my standard errors a lot? Because that can happen, right? So maybe if one of them is quote unquote the correct variance covariance structure, and one of them is the incorrect variance covariance structure, there's going to be a discrepancy there, okay? So that should give you as a data analyst a little bit of pause. If you you're seeing a big discrepancy there. And you might want to go back and really focus on the EEA there. Now, if they're both roughly similar, then you'd say, okay, well, my infra is basically going to be the same regardless of which one of those I choose. They're both having some time-dependent correlation process. They're kind of capturing the general trend across the time. That was the whole goal there, I was seeing. So I think your approach was really kind of to come back to the prediction assessment, which I didn't really ask for here, right, and say, and it's fine. I mean, if prediction was my goal, that's exactly what I'd be doing, right? I'd be looking at some sort of cross-validation estimate about a sample prediction if you're doing this. But I really just wanted to kind of focus on saying, is one of these a more reasonable assumption about the variance covering structure in terms of what you're seeing in terms of changes from the standard errors? But would I get different inference on these guys? One minus that correlation between two observations taken arbitrarily. So if one minus your 0.3, 0.69, saying that is the correlation between two observations taken. Now again, if you had no measurement error, that correlation would be 1, in which case your nugget would be 0. Right? So what this is telling you is there is a reasonable amount of measurement error there. In other words, these things are not perfectly correlated as you're kind of coming close in time. There's a lot of correlation still floating around. You have a correlation about 0.7. Yeah. So that would be the interpretation of what that is. And then you would think about that again. If you drew out your variogram, you kind of see that because that variogram should have kind of a part at the bottom, right? It's like above 0. And that's that nugget sitting there.
So that's the nugget at the bottom. That's our measurement. That's our measurement. So nugget is the proportion of the sigma squared plus tau squared, which is sigma squared.
It's not that proportion, though. I mean, it literally is an estimate of the correlation. It's actually much more interpretable than that, right? It's literally an estimate of the correlation as you're kind of shrinking down. So if I took two observations on you, and I was able to do it 2 milliseconds apart, let's not go to 0, that would be the correlation between those two observations, right? And again, with a very reproducible process, you would hope that correlation would be much higher than that, right? So that 0.7 is actually pretty low for a correlation there. That same high measurement there, right? I mean, that's like on the scale of blood pressure, actually. If you start doing this for blood pressure, you're going to have a lot of correlation of 0.7. You start taking it over and over and over. Can't do it at nano setting. You do it every 30 seconds. So I would argue that that's actually a much more interpretable thing than just thinking about. When you look at the variogram, I do use that. When I'm looking at it, I do think about the relative proportion that is accounted for by tau squared, mu squared, sigma squared, right, in my notation. But that's not what the nugget estimate is telling me.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
The other question is, I was looking
up in such a way that it's a theoretical model, right? It's parameterized theoretically, and such a way that that function rho that's up there, what do I know about rho in this theoretical model? This is how you give rise when you take that expectation. You know, I derived it, you wrote it down. I made an assumption about rho as Tij and Tij prime are the same. So this guy goes to 1, right? And so that becomes the total variation at a point, though, right? I mean, so that's the same measurement on the same individual, right? So that's variation in the population. So just thinking about the variance overall across the population. And that's different. I think this actually was a question Monticello had asked as well. That's different from me saying now I'm taking two distinct measurements and I'm pulling them together arbitrarily close in time, right? Which is what the nugget term is, right? So you guys have all dealt with variance of cross-quantification. That's what this thing is. This is total variation, right? If I look at the population, that's that top line that you're drawing there. And I just took the variance across everybody. So all of these things. And all that the variogram is doing is it's taking that and decompartmentalizing. And the decompartmentalization says, this is part of the total variation on the same person. And then this is what happens if I take two measurements on the same person, but I should take them arbitrarily close in time. Then I get this extra component. Hopefully I got that right in terms of my notation that's up there, but one of those parts was the bottom part that I don't remember. You never remember. Yeah, okay, that's fine. Okay. So it's a distinction between saying the same observation and which was the variation in the observation, the same observation across the population, versus two distinct observations, but taken very, very close to time. Okay? Good. All right. And so that's why when you get back, I just skipped it, but when you go back to lecture 9 and you come back to where I was just a minute ago, look at that residual SD. That's the square plus the cos square that's coming from there, right? That's the residual variance for the same measurement.
That's for the measurements. The variogram, when you take it arbitrarily,
correct. Yeah, so that's two. So again, I'm choosing my words very carefully here, right? Between two measurements, two distinct measurements, taken arbitrarily close in time. Okay? It's not the same random variable that you're taking the variance. Okay. Okay. Good. Other questions? Yeah?
This is sort of like what you were talking about before in this question. So should we not get one of those kind of serial correlations?
You can, but when you go to test that, I mean, you can. I mean, there's nothing that says mathematically you can't, right? But you're putting kind of two forms of time-dependent correlation on the model. And the key thing is like this is what Hina found out. When she goes to test that model against, say, this random intercept, she's kind of testing both dependencies of time there. So you can't really distinguish which one is coming from SOAP, which one is coming from the AR process. Now you could have, and you can get at this, right? You could have tested the random intercept and slope model with just independent measurement error versus the random intercept and random slope model with an AR process to see if that adds anything on top of the random slope. That would be fine as well. But again, what happens is you start getting into this lack of identifiability in terms of being able to interpret how the correlation structure is changing as a function of time. But mathematically, you can fit those. I mean, they're defined.
Could I go one slide back for a second? So
for this one? On this one?
No, like with the nugget one against it. So, yeah. No, back.
Sorry.
Yeah, so I thought that I was understanding that, and then I realized that maybe I don't. So these two observations are fairly close together. Are those for different people or for the same?
Same person.
Oh, okay.
Same person. But two distinct observations on the same person arbitrarily close in time. Okay. Same person. Across people, Arsenio, what am I assuming in this class?
Well, basically, it should be...
I'm assuming independence.
Yeah.
Okay. Across people, across clusters, I'm assuming independence, always. Okay? So when I'm referring to these correlations, I'm always talking about within the cluster.
Well, yeah, but I thought if like we align them on the same baseline. Yeah. So
you're borrowing information. There's no question. I'm averaging to get these estimates. I'm averaging across people. When you do that smooth, I'm averaging across people by saying I'm going to assume that the nugget is constant for everybody. That's an assumption, though, right? I mean, again, like measurement error may be dependent upon somebody's attributes, right? I mean, blood pressure. It might be dependent upon how thick the shirt is they're wearing that day in terms of what the measurement error is, right? That's an attribute. And so their nugget would be changing. In other words, the differences in answers I might be getting may be dependent upon, say, the clothing that they're wearing, right? Or how hot it is in the room, or how cold it is in the room. But the key thing is what we're doing, and you're kind of, this is, again, goes back to the difference between time series and longitudinal. I'm making that assumption that it's going to be stationary across clusters so that I can average it.
When it's a distinct observation, so I was like...
Yeah. Just different observation. I'm trying to make the point of different observations on the same unit. I mean, arbitrarily close to that. I get it. They're hard concepts. I mean, they're not easy concepts.
I want to ask the
ring. Yeah.
The ring is the only way we can use the ring to deliver something.
Yeah, so the range by itself, I would argue, is not a particularly interpretable parameter. If you grew up in the era of 1980s spatial statistics, it might be interpretable. You would want to think on that scale, for example. But this is how I can interpret the range, right? It's by doing a transformation on the range. If I've got no nugget, so if the nugget is zero, it becomes a little bit easier. I just take e to the minus. Right, and then that becomes the correlation depending upon whatever the time scale is for one unit apart. So for example, if it were you guys' FEV, that would be years, so it would be thinking about 1 year apart. That was the time scale that you measure everything. Is that right, or are you guys doing months? You guys just analyzed it?
Years,
right, it was 8 years, right? So, yeah, so it would be per year, right? It would be the correlation between two observations on the same subject.
What's the interpretation of this equation? So range itself is...
Yeah.
It's a reparameterization of the model. Yeah, exactly. Remember, I actually have it on a slide earlier when I said, look, you have the continuous AR process. Some people call that an exponential correlation process because you can rewrite it by taking e to the minus 1 over the rho. That was it. Go back to that slide, and I just like let you. Yeah, so range itself, I don't really have a good feel for, per se. And so what I do is I think about it in terms of... Now, it does come from this aspect of, just to give you some historical and context, the reason the terminology range is used, I think, man, I'm on camera, so I'm always guessing. I hate when I guess at these things, but I think it was Peter Diggle, actually, that put forward this concept of what the effective range is. And what he was talking about, this is back in the early days, what he was talking about was he called the effective range the distance, really in space, the geographical distance between two points such that the correlation goes down below, I believe it was 0.05. And what he was getting at there with the effective range was saying, how far do I have to go out in order to have roughly independent data, right, where I don't have to worry about correlation anymore? So that's where this terminology of range is coming from. Again, he put kind of this arbitrary threshold on it. He said correlation of 0.05. How what's the distance I have to be at? So that's where the word comes from.
Is this still a measurement that we use for, say, binary data?
Yeah, well, we're gonna get there. We're gonna get there, but here's the deal, right? When I'm looking at this variogram, where did that variogram go? Did we have a variogram in here?
No.
Wow, you guys know these slides really well. Okay, solid. All right. When I'm thinking about this variogram, is all kind of nice because I've got these standardized residuals, so I've got lots of scatter. Oh, that's the wrong. Sorry. I was just quickly looking for a smoother. Thank you. Well, I don't have a ruler over here. There we go. There's a ruler. Right. So when I'm looking at these residuals, I've got this nice scatter across these things, right? What's going to happen when I go to binary data if I were to just do this on the observer response? Sparsely. It's going to be pretty much useless. So for binary data, we're going to look at something, you guys are going to love this, called the Lorelogram. Log odds ratio gram. So you're going to put things on the odds ratio scale. You're going to think about the log odds ratio scale, which now has range minus infinity to infinity. And then you're going to think about the autocorrelation and the log odds over time. Cool name, right? Lorelogram? Like, what are we going to call this thing? So that's what we're going to have to do there, though, Arnie, because we're not going to be able to do the same trick just on the scale of the observed data. It's going to be way too sparse. It's going to be like those deviance plots that I had back in 2011. They just fall along two lines, and you can't really see anything. So we're going to have to switch it to a different model. So that's coming. But we have to get through today's lecture. I like the lectures, though. Other things? All right. So, let's go back to Bayes then, shall we? All right. So, last time we had set up the model. I tried to give you guys as much intuition as I could behind the Wishart prior, which again is, I would argue, the most commonly used prior when you're thinking about LMUs. And Taylor, you know, your question intrigued me because, you know, I'm used to G priors. G priors are kind of like a weighted average between a point mass prior and like an OLS estimator, effectively. Like Zellner, right? G priors. I think it's Ronald Zellner. But your question intrigued me because I was like, I don't think anybody's actually produced G priors for mixed effects models, and I still don't think anybody's done that. So I did some searching for that last night. So the answer is. Not only, so I think that part of that is computation, part of it is my answer here, which is this is a pretty reasonable set of modeling. Like in terms of it's fast to fit, it's fairly expansive in terms of how you can parameterize the priors for the most part. And it's pretty intuitive in terms of what the priors are, at least on the norms, on the beta coefficients. And then we kind of started to get a handle on what the chart's doing. So that was, I went and did some looking at this. So I don't actually think G priors are actually have even been proposed. To the best of my knowledge, anyways, for the concept of LMEs.
Yeah, I just have one more question just to clarify.
Yeah.
So what's the relationship between empirical bias and mixed effects, like linear mixed effect models? So basically, empirical bias is like.
Yeah. So. Empirical Bayes is a tool that is used in conjunction with frequentist mixed effect model.
Yeah, so just the way to pull out
estimates for little b. Absolutely, absolutely. When someone says that I've got the, you know, I did it, well, nobody should say this, but if they said, I did empirical Bayes, really what they mean is I use the empirical Bayes estimates for the little, the random effects in my measurements of that small. Okay. So now, going back to this, so, remember that I'm talking about the FEV data, something you guys are all familiar with. I wanted to kind of bring it back to something that you guys had just analyzed. And so we're going to reanalyze this again from a fully Bayes perspective, not an empirical Bayes on the random effects, but a fully Bayes perspective where we put priors on the fixed effects coefficients, the random effects, and on the variance components. Okay, so the first thing I had to do, and I'm doing this in JAGS inside of R. It's a pretty, at least from my perspective, for fitting kind of mixed effects models, it's fast, it's easy, and you can visualize things pretty well for diagnostics, and so that's why I'm using it. Okay. There are J plus one, and by tomorrow there will be J plus two MCMC packages that will do this for you. Okay, I mean, it's like everybody's got their newest package, and so if you guys want to, you'll see on your homework where I'm having you do some of this fitting. If you want to use another package, if you want to use SAN, if you want to use SwiftBugs, which is basically JAGS, by the way, feel free to do so if you're more comfortable with something else. So, the first thing I need to do though, because we're kind of just packaging everything up and shipping it outside into an external external program from R, so I need to package up my data as well as my model specification. So I went through this a little bit last time. The data needs to come in a list. And so has everybody in here gotten comfortable with using lists inside of R? If you're not, become comfortable with them. They are extremely useful. Okay, and so if I do like, first of all, the length of this list. So it has length 5, and that's because I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 elements on those things. The beauty of a list, what is the beauty of a list in R?
That's right. You can put multiple data type objects.
Exactly. It's a way to house multiple data types, right? So I could have a simple scalar string for one of these. I could have a matrix for another one. I can have a list of lists. So I can have lists embedded inside of lists. So that is the beauty of working with lists, because you're not always working a common or data type. Okay. And if you've got lists, by the way, so this is just for your own information, if you have a list in R and you want to write it out and read it back in, how do you do that? Do you know how to do this? And I won't write it out of R. That will take it away from being a list, and then you can write it out as something else, but that will lose all the structure of it, right? So now if everything's a different data type, you wouldn't have that. So here. So maybe I've got a vector, and then I've ran some simulations, and I've got results of those simulations. So A might be my vector of random seeds on simulations. Results that are sitting there. So if I look at temp, again, it's got two different kinds of data types that are inside of it. I want to maintain that structure, and I want to write that out and store it, and later on maybe bring it back in so I can do things with it or recreate my results or whatever the case may be.
Dput.
Data put, right? So data put, temp, wherever I want to put that thing is your friend. If I do that and I stick it out, that now is just an object. It's an R-based object that's sitting on my desktop. And if I want to pull it back in, dget, and that will maintain the structure of that thing. So when I do a dget on that, I pull it back in and I've got it all there. It's extremely valuable to be able to do that, okay, as you're working in simulations and doing data analyses where you've got multiple structures and you need to save something. You don't always want to recreate it inside of the R session. You want to save it and pull it back in. You put, you get, those are your friends. Okay, that's just an aside. But that's ultimately what's happening here, by the way, when you create this list and you put this thing out. It's being written out and it's being pulled back in.
Can you do that with any other data structure?
Yes. With any other data structure? Yeah, no, you can't. So if I just had a simple vector, I could do a dput and dget. There it becomes easier for people oftentimes to do, for example, a write.csv or a write.table, because that's something somebody else can read. Like, nobody's going to be able to read that structure if they're not working in R. Okay, so that's like for you to be working with. Okay, so something useful that you've learned today. Good. So now, in terms of specifying the model, I went through this last time. The key points here, a couple of them are that the model kind of almost looks specified backwards in some fashion. That's because you're kind of going hierarchical, right? I'm starting at the random effect at the individual level, then I'm going to the fixed effect, and then I'm specifying my mean model, right? So it's almost like this hierarchy that's coming through, but it's almost a backwards hierarchy in the way we think about the problem. We think about the problem in terms of saying, let me specify the mean model. It's a function of the fixed effects, and then that's a function of the random effects, right? It's written in a little bit in reverse. I talked about the specification of priors based upon what I was showing you guys last time. Again, key point here, everything is parameterized in terms of precisions and precision matrices. So that means I'm putting a variance on of 1 over 0.0001. Okay, thanks, guys. I'm gonna reinforce this later on. This is totally, I would argue, fine for a quote-unquote uninformative prior in the setting of, or a diffuse prior, right, Ben? Sorry. In the setting of a linear model. When we get to nonlinear models, that becomes a very dangerous thing to do because it basically forces mass on probability 0 or 1, for example, in a logistic regression model. I don't know if you guys have seen this in 205. 205, did we fit a logistic model through Bayes? Yeah, yes or no? We didn't. Okay. Okay. Well, we're going to do it in here. Well, we're going to fit a GLMF. Okay. So in the linear model case, again, I'll bring it back up later. This is kind of fine for a diffuse prior, a very diffuse prior on these things. The reason why it becomes dangerous, for example, in a logistic regression is because what does beta mean in a logistic regression model? It's the log odds, right, in a logistic regression model. So if you're putting prior mass on like a log odds of 500, what is that doing? That's putting mass on an odds ratio of e to the 500. Anybody seen those lately? No, I hope not. Okay, I hope not. So, yeah. So, anyways, but here it can be diffuse, right? There's no constraints on these parameters. Okay. So I've done all of that. We've got it all set up here. Now I'm going to just specify my model. So this is just opening up a text connection to RJAG so that I can ship everything off to it now that it's packed up. That's what this model 1.specification is on the text connection. I guess I probably should specify these things. I walked through them, but I didn't actually specify them last time. And again, everything that I have here for my model 1 is literally just a text string. It's just commands that are going out. It's not running just yet. And then finally, for the JAGS model, I'm going to specify that. I haven't taken any samples yet, but I'm kind of preparing to take samples here, right? So the major things that you need are the model specification, putting up front, and then the data that you're going to be feeding into that. That's my list that I put together. And then a couple of other things that you're usually going to want to specify. So the number of chains that are going to run. So again, we're doing Gibbs sampling, remember? So we're going to start off at different points in time. And the reason why you run different chains is because you're hoping to converge upon the same points. If you're not converging upon the same posterior estimates, then there's probably a problem in the sampling process. So that's why we run multiple chains. It's more of a diagnostic to make sure that things are kind of converging to the same answer. Right? It'd be unsettling. I start one chain at a value of 2 and another chain at a value of minus 1, and they continue to go to different places, and I got 2 different answers. You're hoping everything converges off, so that's why you'd be doing multiple chains. And then finally, in ADAPT, we don't really need here because I already showed you guys that we could write down all of our conditional posterior distributions, and that means I can do what type of sample? Gibbs, right? Gibbs, which has what acceptance rate? It's full Gibbs. It's 1, right? It's 100%. Every time I draw, I get a new sample, right? It's on these. I can draw straight from the conditionals. Now, the INADAPT is sometimes you can't write down all of, for some models, you can't write down all of the conditionals, and so you have to do Gibbs within Metropolis. Okay? And so there you have to do a Metropolis haste test. Okay? And so in those cases, there's a probability of acceptance or probability of rejection. I talked about this last time. So the proposal that you get in a Metropolis Hastings is kind of what we call the proposal of the step size. Okay, how far you're going to kind of jump out to propose a new value for your parameter. The INADAPT, basically this would say I'm going to take the first 100 draws and I'm going to change the proposal step size to try and maximize the acceptance rate. That's what that's doing. So with that INADAPT command there. So in our case, I can set it to 100 or I can set it to 0 and I'll get the same answer because guess what? It's 100% acceptance. There's no proposal that's going on here because we're all Gibbs. But if you're doing something that Metropolis requires a rejection sampling algorithm like Metropolis Hastings, INADAPT comes handy. Okay? It'll try and tune basically the step size for you to get you a better acceptance rate. Okay, so that's what those four guys are, and if you look at this then you will say, okay, it's going to go ahead and compile the model for you. It's basically putting the pieces from the hierarchy in order, so that's what it means by allocating the nodes, as we through 757 observations, 105 unobserved nodes. Those are going to be the random effects on each individual, so as we go through in just a second. So I'll talk more about that. So now, when I actually want to draw samples from this model, there are a couple of things. Like the standard function that you would use is something called jags.samples, which, yeah, that's a pretty apt name, right? You're using jags to draw samples. I tend to actually use the coda.samples function, which you have to read in coda, which is covariance diagnostics. And the reason why is it because it gives me kind of nice diagnostic plots on my chains later on. The samples would be the same, basically, but coda kind of packages it nicely so I can examine if I've got autocorrelation on my chains. And I'm going to do that here. So that's why I tend to use coda.samples. All right, so what I'm doing is I'm saying, look, here is my JAGS model. I'm going to feed that into coda.samples. These are the covariates that I want to store. All right, I'm sorry, the covariates. The parameters that I want to store, okay, as I'm drawing on samples. So I want to hold the marginal intercept, the marginal longitudinal parameter, and the marginal cross-sectional parameter, as well as the components of the variance-covariance matrix for the random effects, and then the residual error term, right? So I'm gonna hold all of those guys in memory as I'm doing examples. That's what I'm asking for here. Okay. And then finally, the iteration says that's how many draws I'm really gonna pull off, so 10,000 of them. So I'm gonna run through this cycle the full way, so conditionally sampling on each one of these parameters. As I go through all parameters, that's one iteration, okay? And come back through. And then finally, the thinning is going to be, it's basically saying that I want to keep every 10th observation. Okay, so thinning is your friend oftentimes in CMC. Because what you would like to have, and I talked about this last time, is you would like to have truly independent draws on the posterior distribution. Like if you could go in and call R norm and just have independence come up. But Gibbs, remember, is working kind of cyclically. It's taking your last parameter value, conditioning upon it, pulling off the next parameter value. And so there's going to be induced correlations that are going through as you're sampling off as you go through. So the idea here behind thinning is to say, well, if I only keep, in this case, every 10, maybe I can reduce that autocorrelation. It's like going out farther and farther in time, if you will. Okay. You had a hand up first, Francis.
So really your effective sample size is 1,000.
Divided by 10, exactly. Yeah, the 10,000 divided by 10 or 1,000.
Exactly.
That's right. So I have a question about thinning, because I heard like different opinions somewhere whether or not it's like useful in a sense. And for example, if you just want to estimate the standard deviation of beta 0, and even without thinning, this distribution should approximate the posterior, and we can just keep all the samples and
I'm going to show you something in just a second that might repeat that just a little bit. Okay. It is true that you'll get a relatively reasonable approximation of where the center of that density is. But in terms of the variance, not quite as much necessarily. Okay. So you'll see in just a second. I'll show you an example. So what I'm going to do is draw these off. So hold the question, Arsenio, and we'll come back to it. Okay? So right now this thing is working. It's kind of saying, look, I've drawn 10% of these samples, 34% of these samples. It's going to take a second. Okay. That, by the way, is still like one of the world's fastest like biggest fits that you're ever going to have. So if you get more complicated samples, it's going to take you like 10 days to do something. So enjoy that. Okay. So now, if I think about what just came out to me, so if I look at the length of it is 4. If I look at the head of it, you can see why the length of it is 4. It's because it's giving me back a list, and the elements of that list are each of the 4 separate chains that I've drawn off of. Okay, so that's the length being 4. And you can see that as I look at the head of it, this up here is telling me, oh, it started keeping observations at the 10th observation. That's because I asked it to thin every 10, so it didn't keep the first 9. Okay? And it held the 10. Okay? And It's ending here only at 70, only because I've asked for the head of this thing. Okay? This really goes farther and farther and farther and farther, all the way to 1,000, right, Francis? Okay. So, and then what you have is exactly what you would want, right? These are just the draws that are coming off for each of the parameters that I asked to store as I'm pulling from the Gibbs sample, right? And so this is for the first chain, this is for the second chain, third chain, fourth chain. So now, if you wanted to just focus on a particular chain and you look at the dimensions of that particular chain, so for the first one, it's just the first element of that list then that came back. That again now has the 1,000 draws that I have really pulled off of and asked for, and then the 7 parameters that I've asked to draw inference on. Okay? And then finally, the dimension names, if you wanted to just make sure that you have those to pull them off, it's what you would hope, right? These are the parameters that I have requested for. Okay. So now, as I come through, so let's do some diagnostics here. So let's plot the chains, and I'm going to plot these chains now for the longitudinal parameter for beta L. This is something you guys have been dealing with. Homework. So all I'm doing is I'm saying for each of my chains, go through and plot 1 to 1,000, and then the samples that were drawn off for beta L. And then the rest of this is just putting labels on so that I can make it look somewhat nice. So those are my four chains. And there's a couple of things about these chains. These are basically what you want to see, okay, in terms of sampling. They're all effectively centered at about the same value, about minus 2, okay, regardless of where I started. That's fine, I'm not getting stuck anywhere. They all kind of look like this fuzzy worm, some people would say, right? And so they're all mixing very, very well. Okay, so that means that there's not a lot of autocorrelation inside of those chains as well. So that's kind of what you would want to see. Now, let me do this real fast. I'm going to do it for beta C. That's not what you want to see. You see the difference there? There is high autocorrelation in every one of those things. Oh, I did hold these. All right, I kept these Y limits. What do I want here? What would be reasonable Y limits for me? Minus 3 up to say positive 3. Let's just do it like that. So you can get a little bit better picture. There you go. But that's not what you want to see in terms of mixing. This fact that I've got these long trends that are going on here is telling me that I've got high autocorrelation. Okay, so in other words, I'm not drawing anywhere near, that's with thinning every time. I'm not drawing anywhere near independent samples. So I'll come back to Arsenio's question in just a minute because we're going to look at this beta C and we're going to try and deal with getting independent draws. So other things though that I might want to do now, one of the views, oh yes, Arsenio.
Yeah, so actually, on these, the first chains that you said look good.
Yeah.
So, but you still could sort of see that. Yes. So I had a question initially because.
Oh wait, no.
Yes. So you could still see kind of this structure.
Yeah. You see what structure?
So
ups and downs. That's on the same scale though of data. That is noise. I mean, you're going to be bouncing around. But these things that you're going one interval or...
No. So these spikes are certainly noise. But if you look at the like the most dense region, it is like a jigsaw to an extent. So and this means that they're like you can sort of see some relation even from here. So is it like this one really the one we want to see, or we would like to see even the dense region to be completely like straight?
I won't show you. Fine, I won't show you my density plots then. I won't show you something else. No. This is jumping ahead just a little bit. But this is kind of a classic descriptive plot that you might use, right? So this is called an autocorrelation function plot, right? So this is that just estimating, just like we've been doing like with a variogram, estimating the correlation between observations as I go through. And I've drawn red lines in because I like to have visuals when I start to think about things, but those red lines are plus or minus 0.1. So this is on beta L, okay? And so you can see that as I just jump off to my 10th observation out, my correlation is basically 0.03. So that's what I would argue. So if you want an empirical assessment of saying, is that plot okay? I mean, the plot is just, it's very subjective, right? You can look at that and say, maybe there is some sort of waviness going on in there. This is kind of more of an empirical assessment that says, yeah, you're pretty much drawn into the same. I mean, this is about what you'd want in an ACF plot. That's what I would argue. This is about as good as it's going to get. Okay. On the flip side of that, though, if I look at the ACF plot for beta C, right? I mean, that's what the correlation is looking like for beta C. So that's, there's a big difference there in terms of what the empirical assessment of the correlation is.
Okay. These are already thin.
These are already thin. So this is over 300 observations, 300 lags, right, as I'm going through. And it's telling me that if I multiply that by 10, right, if I didn't thin each thing, that's over 3,000. So we will need to deal with that, and we will deal with that in just a second. But before I do that, let me go back to one of the beauties of Bayes' methods, is you're drawing inference, or your inferential statements, your probability statements are directly on the parameter, which again is nice for people. They like to think on that scale. And again, frequency statistics, I think we've learned to think on the scale of saying making probability statements on the data given parameter. But it is kind of comforting to say, yeah, I'd like to know something about just the distribution of the actual parameter, right? So one of the things I'll typically do is just kind of take a density estimator. Oops, I actually want this to be, there's going to be four of these guys. There we go. Take a density estimator across the chains, for example, or beta L. And so now you can see that, oh, okay, as I'm thinking about drawing inference now on the longitudinal effect of aging within the subject, I can see that my center is about -2. And then I can start to look and say, yeah, and probability intervals for that guy are sitting somewhere in between, say, about -2.75 and about -1.25. Right? We're going to do that a little bit more technically, quantitatively in just a second, but it's kind of a nice visual, right, that you can give to somebody and say, this is kind of my best estimate of that effect, that fixed effect, and this is my uncertainty in that estimate, okay? Okay, so now, and by the way, we're gonna come back to this in just a minute, but if I were to fit a frequentist mixed effects model, that's my MLE estimate, and it better be agreeing pretty well in this case because I've got really big use priors on this thing. Okay, so I haven't really put a ton of prior information into my model here. So the fact that you're seeing a posterior mode at around -2 is not too surprising given that this is what we have to do for this mixed effects analysis. All right. Good. Okay. So there are some slightly more automated schemes. So for example, if I just do a plot to SAMS CODA, so I kind of took each one of these things out, but if I take, say, for example, the first element of the list and just do a plot on that, then this is what CODA would give you back. It will give you back, for the first chain, it will give you back the draws that you have, the trace plot, we would say, and it'll give you back an estimate of the density. So that's kind of what I had done on for all four chains put together. But this is if you just do a plot on the CODA output, you'll get this guy back. Okay. And finally, if I do just a plot on all of them from CODA, it'll give me back all four chains kind of laid on top of one another. And it'll give me the density when I've pulled all of those chains together. Okay, so it's treating all of the samples pulled together. Which is ultimately where you would draw inference from. So again, just going back to some of the points I was making, if you look at beta C, you can see a pretty big difference, I would argue, there between that and, say, beta L in terms of the mixing for the Gibbs draws. Do you see it anywhere else? Beta 0. It turns out that the poor mixing is actually high between those two things. Okay. Because what is beta 0? Yeah, but give me an interpretation of beta zero in our model. You guys know the model now, and Alpha used it on homework. So what is beta zero in that model? Is it that model you're working on homework?
So just
beta zero. The expected FEV for someone who has age
zero.
Ready start. So what's happening is beta zero is like extrapolated off from the rest of your data. You guys don't have anybody that's zero here today, right? The data set, they're all pretty far away. So extrapolating off, and so it's having a hard time getting a handle on beta zero. They just don't have any data around that point. And because of that, it's also having a hard time getting a handle on beta C, because they're tied, they're inherently tied together. Okay. So what might be a fix then if you wanted to deal with that? The way I just now explained that problem for you, how might you fix it?
Reparameterize
it in terms of what? Maybe mean center age, right? So then if I mean center age, what does the intercept imply? What is it, or what is it interpreted as? The mean FEV at the mean age of my sample at the start of baseline, which I have plenty of data on. Okay. So now, let's do a couple of things, okay? So you guys already saw some issues with the autocorrelation on those two things. I showed you the ACF plots already. You can see that come up in beta C. One of the things that folks might say is, well, you know, sometimes, like if you were looking at this plot, you might say, well, I haven't quite gotten to the heart of the posterior distribution yet. In other words, I'm still working there, okay? And in that case, you might want to do something we call burn-in. So in other words, throw away the first few samples, okay? So the way that you can do that in JAGS is you can use the window function. And so, for example, I can take my CODA output that's there, and I'd say start at 1001. What that means is throw away the first 1,000 observations as a burn-in. Okay. There's actually, it's windowed because you can do an end as well. But you don't, I don't necessarily want an end right now. Okay, so I just want to toss the first 1,000 observations. So you would do that because your starting point isn't often right at the kind of mode, for example, of your posterior distribution. It takes you a while to get there, right? And so you're sampling off of places that really aren't part of your posterior. And so if that's happening and you see kind of a long chain at the beginning, you might want to toss those samples. We call it burning those samples, right? Okay. So again, that's not really an issue in the things that we're seeing here. And even in this case, we're sitting somewhere around the mean, but what you've got is you've just got high autocorrelation in these guys. So, but I'm just showing it to you guys for an example. Sometimes you will see this long kind of trail coming down as you're trying to really sample from the heart of the posterior. So that's what would happen. So if I looked at the dimensions now CODA after I did that windowing, you can see that it starts at 900. That's because it threw away the first 1,000 samples and I'm dividing by 10 for the thing. Okay. Okay. All right. So the other final nice thing, and again, well, I'm going to go back to the underlying autocorrelation in just a second. But the other nice thing about this is that when I look at just do a summary of sams.coda, now these are the things that you're typically going to want to have, right? So what this is saying, okay, for each of my parameters, let's focus on beta L for a second because we got this issue in sampling beta C right now, but focus on beta L. You can see that the median now of all my samples is about minus 1.96. Again, what was it in the frequentist bit? Minus 1.97. Okay, so it's pretty much right on top of that. If I wanted, for example, a 95% probability interval for beta L, so in other words, taking the lower 2.5 percentile and the upper 97.5 percentile, that's about minus 2.5 to minus 1.43. Again, go back to, go back and do confidence interval. It's ridiculous that the summary for an LME fit does not do a confidence interval. Write your congressman. see what they do about that. The confidence intervals I did it before I came into class, they will match up quite closely with what you can see as well for the 95% probability interval as well. Part of that is because, guess what, this thing looks nice and normal, right? As you would expect. Okay. It's effectively normal. All right. So now, that I might do to try and address this guy here. If I didn't give you guys the intuition behind the tie-in between the intercept and the age, the cross-sectional age effect, one of the things you would probably do is you'd say, well, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to increase thinning. Okay, so one of the things I could have done was said, okay, I'll thin every 300, for example. So now as I go through, that'd be kind of ridiculous. I know you guys are laughing at me. Actually, less than 100. I want some samples here. But I could have done three. And then, do I still have beta C down here? I don't. Do this. Let that guy run for just a second. So all I'm doing now is trying to increase independence, if you will, by keeping samples that are further and further apart. If I go to the autocorrelation plot now, then, oops, R in my face. Well, it's just because it's just sitting on its 4 2x2. I can fix that. So that's what happens now if I just thin to every 100. Okay, so I don't keep every 10th one, I keep every 100th one. So I can start to bring that down on what my samples are as I'm going through. But I'm still kind of up and down above 0.1, which is, that's kind of like my upper threshold on these things. So I'd have to thin even more than that, to be quite honest, to deal with this. But an easier way to do this is to say, well, in my data, maybe I'll mean center age, right? And that's what we just now talked about. So now I'm just going to go back and I'm going to mean center age. Remember, it doesn't change interpretation of what that coefficient is. And it's true that this has repeated age zeros in here, but you know it's roughly the mean zero or the age zero value average across the population. So now if I go to that, model string doesn't change. It does change a shift on this guy. Go back through, reinitialize, and draw my sample. Oops. Ah. Sorry. I want to do this at just 10 again. Come on. That would actually probably be fine, to be quite honest with you. You guys are paranoid. Paranoid. Come on, it would have been fine. Draw every 10th off. Little. Exactly. Thank you, Francis. You gotta get a little excited. Geared up to show you guys just how easily you can fix this problem in this case. At least my ACF plot, is it better than what we had before? What was the ACF plot before?
Yeah, it was
pretty bad before, right?
It was like
when lost it down. Yeah. So I might do a combination then. How's that? So I wouldn't have been okay with one, so don't take that as your... So now if I had been every year, let's see if we can get this guy to have something reasonable. And Arsenio's sitting there and he's saying, yeah, but you know what? None of this matters because I told you you don't have to have independence. So I'm still going to come back and address that, okay? You want independence wrong. Okay. So now, if I bin every 100, let's see what we did here. That's slightly better. I'm still bouncing outside more than what I had. I'm going to check this for you guys and come back and see what I got going on. If you guys, and you guys play with it for me, just mean center age, and that should take just about everything away. Okay? But I will check it one more time. I think I'm rewriting. But let me go to my notes real fast and kind of try and address something that Arsenio had said before. And then I want to spend 5 more minutes kind of thinking about inference on the model. So that's my beta L chains that are seen there. This was the problems with beta C that we had seen before. Beta L looks good, beta C looked horrible. Oh, there's my original one. This is now thinning at every 500. That's about the same impact of what I had when I was just now mean centering and thinning every 100, so that's at least a saving of 100. Okay. And then finally, this is what I wanted to kind of show you here, Arsenio. Right, so this is the empirical mean and then standard error that's coming from those draws, right, where this is what we would call the naive standard error on that on those draws for those coefficients. And look at beta C real fast. And then look at what happens when you account for the fact that you've got autocorrelation inside of those guys. So now the answer is you could keep the autocorrelation in there and try and adjust the standard errors on your inference through something like a standard error estimated that adjusts for the autocorrelation. Or you can just try and fix the mixing, which is what I just now did. In this type of problem, I just try and fix the mixing to get it and it draws. But that's big, okay? I mean, that's like a two-fold difference, right? You know, it's on the opposite side of that, so it's actually more than that. It's almost a six-fold difference.
Sure, I agree. But, I mean, definitely it would be better if samples are independent. But what I mean is that, for example, physically, we are running 1,000 samples and only keeping every 10, for example.
Yeah.
But if we take all this 1,000 and adjust, I think it should be no worse than keeping every 10.
What do you mean and adjust?
Well, adjust for this autocorrelation.
So adjust for it here. So readjust all my inference. Yeah?
Yeah, for
okay.
Example.
But when you readjust for that inference, that time series standard error that's sitting there, So what I'm saying is, particularly in a model like this, it's a lot easier to just fix it in the chain model, particularly if it's something like centering, mean centering the variable. My key point here is one or the other, you do not want to keep draws that have that high autocorrelation and just do inference on those draws, because that's what's happening with the standard error on those, right? That's the difference. I mean, this is an assumption-based fix, right? When I'm accounting for some of the autocorrelation in that. It's really an exponential autocorrelation in the AR process. But it's still showing you what the impact of that is. Okay, so you do want to have something going on. Now, whether you're going to thin, which is a very popular approach, particularly when you can draw samples fairly inexpensively, or whether you're going to do something that's like an adjustment on all of the samples coming through, the key point is your effective sample size when you do this is still coming down because of the dependence in those guys. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I just wonder how empirically so I just trying to wrap my head around the fact that this should approximate the posterior, right? And so basically if you calculate statistics on that, I would expect that to be also approaching what we want, right? And so, while I agree that, we might lose some efficiency, but for example, if we have 1,000 not really efficient samples and 100 a bit more efficient samples, why would we prefer 100? Because we're still not in the independence scenario.
We're a lot closer to it. think I just showed you that. I think that shows you that. But the point is that, yeah, you're drawing from the posterior, and if you let this thing run to 10 million, you will sample all the way across that thing. But because of the autocorrelation, particularly as you start bringing down the number of draws, you're starting to sample more from particular areas of that posterior distribution, and that's what's drawing your inference. Now, the mean here is basically the mean that we're going to get at the end of the day. You're absolutely right on that part. But the variation that I'm seeing as I'm pulling off these samples is much lower than what I see. So when I go to formulate a 95% probability interval, it's looking a lot smaller than what it should. I mean, it's drawing around, but the samples, because they're correlated, tend to be close to one another. And so it's saying there's less variation if you treated them as independent than what you do.
So this time series standard error,
yeah.
That's calculated by hitting like a AR1 process?
It's basically like an AR process that then estimates what's called the effective sample size. So in other words, like if I had truly independence, I would have two observations. But if I had a correlation of 1, I really have 1 observation. And so if I have a correlation between 0 and 1, it's somewhere between 1 and 2 observations, right? And so this is accounting for the fact that you have an effective sample size for that, based upon the other. Okay. Good. So I want to finish up this lecture so that I can get to GEE next time. But I've already shown you guys quantiles here. And again, I've drawn off kind of pseudo-independent samples, at least on the cross-sectional effect. But now I want to show you something about the random effects, right? So last time we did empirical Bayes to try and come up with saying what might be the posterior mean, quote-unquote posterior mean, of little b given our data in the fixed samples, or in the frequentist estimation setting. Now what I want to do is draw off, since I'm doing everything from a Bayes perspective, I can literally just go and now draw off from the posterior for the individual random effects. So now what I'm doing is I'm rerunning CODA, but what I'm saying I want to keep now are the beta 0 i's and the beta l i's. In other words, these are the individual level intercepts and the individual level longitudinal parameters. Okay? So I didn't keep those last time. The reason why is because I want to hold on to the level parameters. I showed you guys everything, but now I'm going to hold on to them until I have one of these for each subject. So I'm going to go ahead and rerun these guys. So it's the same call that I had before. And I'm going to go ahead and save this summary now because it's going to be kind of big. So if I now, let's do this. What this is now giving me back, I'll go through each one of them before you cause that, I'm going to make you guys suffer with me. So for each one of these now, you've got the summary of the draws, and I've got one of these for each individual that's inside of my data set now, right? So that's the first subject, second subject, third subject. This is for their longitudinal parameter, slope parameter, that's their mean, standard deviation, and the time corrected. And again, this is what you would want to see, right? Again, telling you something about the difference between the draws. Okay. Not a big adjustment going on there. And then I have the same thing for their random intercepts. And then finally, there's the quantiles, which ultimately, this is what you would probably want to be reporting from an inferential perspective and saying, OK, now I've got, here's my individual, the first subject, my quote unquote best estimate, in other words, the median of their posterior interval for their longitudinal component is about -2. By the way, that person is sitting right on the population, right? It's about -1.97 for the population estimate, so there's not a lot of shrinkage going on there. And then for that individual, though, you've got a 95% probability interval ranking from about -5 to about 0.7. A lot bigger variation, but that's what you would expect, right? You would expect to see that because it's just on the individual level now. It's not on the population. Everybody with me right now on what I'm doing? Okay, good. Good, good, good. So in order to be able to actually relate these to folks, what I tend to do is like create a forest plot. So I'm just setting a seed right now because I'm just going to randomly draw 20 subjects from the data set. And so I'm going to take 20 of these quote-unquote participants inside of the data set. I'm going to bring in a package called R-Meta, which is R-Meta Analysis is what it's made for, so combining the different studies, but it has access to a nice function called a forest plot. There's some setup that you have to do here, but once you do it and you call forest plot, I'll let you guys run through my code. That's the type of thing you might be wanting to see, right? Is saying, okay, now these are my subject IDs that are here. These are my median estimates for what their slope is, for example. Or these are their intercepts, sorry, for their intercept. And then this is my credible interval, and that's a visual plot to kind of show exactly what's happening with them under posterior. Okay? So that's the way I would typically try and produce like inference in a case like this to show the heterogeneity across those. Okay. And you can do the same thing, obviously, for their longitudinal slope measures as well that you wanted to go through. Okay.
Might just imagine this or the boxes?
These boxes actually here are different sizes, and they're different sizes relative to the amount of information, exactly sample size that are in there. And so I do have in my code, you'll see I write an option into forest plot that allow you to maintain the same size if you wanted to, or that will scale them relative. So I find that to be kind of a handy thing to relate now at the end of the day. These are my posterior samples. You don't really want to draw into these problems. You just put in the case or number. So you don't want that. What this is really clearly telling you is there are some people that have a high trait, tend to be very high in their FEVs at the beginning. Some people that tend to be quite low. There's a lot of variation in this data set with respect to intercepts that's coming on here. These are, again, your posterior estimates. Okay. So with that, I will leave you guys now, and I've asked you to kind of recreate a Bayes analysis. You can either use my code here, or you can go to another package if you want for the Bayes analysis, but to do that for the CD4 data, the max data that I've done in the last from a frequency perspective. And so you guys can okay, thanks guys. I will see you on Tuesday, unless you guys want to have class Monday.